is
mm-hmm.
I told them.
Thank you so much for joining us. And up on the screen, I have our agenda. Today, we are excited to hear from the Elgin Symphony Orchestra. I think Eric is on his way to joining, but before that, we have a couple of announcements from the board. And let me just introduce myself. My name is Diana Manjarres. I'm the president of the Elgin Hispanic Network, and I work for the Grand Victoria Foundation. I'll stop sharing my screen because I think we all need to see each other a little bigger in the screen. For our announcements, Diana Ortega, Eric wasn't able to join us, but she has exciting announcements for our scholarship program. The scholarship committee worked really hard to make decisions about the recipients, and we actually received 17 applications this year, which is amazing given the circumstances. And so thank you so much to the scholarship committee for doing that work to promote the scholarship and then select the best participants. We wish we could give scholarships to everyone, but we had to make a decision and pick three. So in the month of June, we will be sharing who the winners are, and hopefully they will be able to join us for a meeting and you guys can all congratulate them and get to know them a little better. I think that's it for announcements. We are in the planning stages and decision stages of how our picnic will look this year, so please stay tuned for that. We will be sending out a list of different supplies that we will need. As you know, we put together baskets for the recipients so that when they go out to college, they have a little care package from all of us at EHN. So David and Linda will be following up with everyone with a list of things that you can help us contribute. David, do you want to add anything?
No, that's pretty much right. Every year when we do get our college recipients, one thing we love to do is sending them with a survival kit. We call it like a survival kit, right? Yeah, more information to come and what is needed or how you can help us put these baskets together. And then as Diana said as well, we're going to have more information about the June picnic and see what that's going to all look like as well. So more information to come. Stay tuned. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, David. Any other announcements from other board members that maybe I missed? Okay, well then our next item is to welcome Eric Monquist from the Elgin Symphony Orchestra and for him to share more information about the symphony.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Diana. Thank you guys for having me for this, and thanks to the Hispanic Network for the support. It's actually our final concert that we had was with the partnership with EHN, and that was back on March 7th of 2020, which is difficult to believe that it's now been over a year since the Elgin Symphony Orchestra left the stage for the last time. Diana, am I able to share my screen?
Co-host?
Terrific. Thank you so much. Great. So I just thought, it just since it's been a bit of an odd year, I just give everybody a little bit of an update as to what we've been doing as a symphony. And this has been a forcing function for all of us across all industries. And I think that there's been some really interesting adaptations in the orchestral world. And we've taken our own angle. So again, like I said, we canceled our last concert. It was the last concert we had was on March 7th of 2020. And then at that point, we made the decision to cancel the remainder of the 2020 season and started into the kind of soul searching about what it means to be an orchestra at a time when you can't present orchestral music. Across our industry, you saw almost uniform switch to virtual programming. Almost everybody put on the very standard fare, but did it digitally. And so we as an orchestra had a real reckoning moment to decide what exactly it meant to be the Elgin Symphony specifically. And I think that the difficult but honest truth that we've arrived at was that we are an orchestra that is not the Chicago Symphony, is not the New York Philharmonic, and therefore doesn't have as strong a place in that ecosystem of purely presenting orchestral music for digital consumption, and that our function, the reason that we exist in a city like Elgin, is to be an advocate for our community and to be a sort of coming together place for community events. And so we've made this pivot, and I know that everybody hates the word pivot this year, but we made the pivot to making sure that everything we do had some sort of direct community impact. It could be as simple as a moment for gathering and enjoying space, enjoying music, enjoying culture safely, and it can be some other community advocacy things, which I'll talk about a little bit later. So the first programs that we did after our summer, where we did some virtual lectures and things, we did two outdoor concerts, one at Gobert's Farm out in Pingree Grove, and the second one in downtown Elgin. It was important to us to do these in downtown Elgin, as we see a portion of our mission as economic development for the downtown area, and the fact that we bring more people into downtown Elgin than any event, including Nightmare on Chicago Street. We tried to put as many events as we can as close to downtown Elgin businesses as we can, in an effort to bring our patrons and our patrons' patronage into downtown businesses. So that was how we kicked off the very unusual 2021 season with very low capacity programs, but with our music director back on the podium and a reduced version of the Elgin Symphony Orchestra. Here's some pictures from those evenings. They were lovely. Obviously a very non-traditional concert formats, but you see on the far left there and to the top middle, those are from the Hate in downtown Elgin created just a beautiful outdoor space. And we managed to shoehorn the orchestra in with 6 feet of distance between each player, everybody masked, and the bottom two on the right and the top right, those are all from Gobert's Farm out in Pingree Grove. We also decided, part of the consideration that we had here is the people most hard hit by all of this are the freelance musicians. The musicians that we employ make most of their living, not as members of the Chicago Symphony, but largely as subs with the Chicago Symphony and subs with the Lyric Opera of Chicago. And so when those orchestras closed down, the work that they rely on completely dried up entirely. And so we were trying to figure out how to get our musicians employed in a way that was impactful and ticked off those boxes that I talked about earlier about having community impact. And so we tried our best to employ, and actually did succeed in employing, or at least offering employment to every one of the 68 contracted musicians of the symphony. This included, we did a concert with Advocate Sherman Hospital, where they presented, our entire brass and percussion section did a concert for essential workers out on the patio at Sherman. We played for a string quartet concert for the Blessing of New Homes at Habitat for Humanity. We had a string trio that played a concert for the long lines that were developing for Food for Greater Elgin, which was having extreme demand and also hadn't quite figured out how to mitigate, how to implement COVID mitigation with those long lines. And so we had a trio out there playing while people were waiting for 2 hours. And then I think my personal favorite was we partnered with the Housing Authority of Elgin, and we placed a string quartet in the middle of the three Central Park towers in downtown, just on the other side of the river, where seniors could watch from their windows of their residences, or we placed seats at 6 foot distance down in the residential area. So seniors that would traditionally not be able to interact with music, we were able to put on a very full program. We distributed programs to the residents so they could see and be a part of it and experience it like a more traditional concert than almost anything else we did. Here's some photos from this, starting from the top left and going clockwise. Top left is Food for Greater Elgin. Top right is at Housing Authority of Elgin. Bottom right is at the Habitat for Humanity. That's string quartet in the garage right there. That's going to be a new format for concerts, if ever there was one. And in bottom left is our brass ensemble playing at the patio of Advocate Sherman Hospital. Now, next on kind of our tour of community impact, we had a really, really fun program. And, you know, I have to say the thing that's most disappointing about anything we've done this year is that I think we've put together some really compelling programs musically, intellectually, and artistically, and they're only able to be viewed by such a small group of people in person, although they've all had a digital component to them. This was, I think, my favorite program of the year. We took the string principals from our orchestra, and we commissioned original poetry from Elgin's poet laureate, Cassidy Gunn. And I forgive me if this gets a little wonky and nerdy, but what we use as a predicate for the program is the Dvorak American String Quartet, which is a piece of music that Dvorak, who is a Czech composer, wrote when he came to visit the United States. And so this piece was a 19th century European white male visitor's perspective on what it means to be American, what it looks like to be American through a through an audio postcard. And so in our collaboration with Chastity, we commissioned original poetry to go between the movements of this quartet, which was a 21st century black woman's perspective on what it means to be American. And she created the most beautiful and just touching poetry that went between these movements and kind of augmented that juxtaposition in just a beautiful way. And Chastity, actually, I wasn't aware, is a very fine singer herself. And so she actually sang little bits with little improv cello lines from, you see there, our principal cello, Matt Agnew. Lovely program. We also commissioned original art from local artist Melina Scott, which you see there on the right in a very blurry image that I apparently downloaded quite badly. Apologies. We also had a really, really terrific thank you event where Itzhak Perlman, the kind of great violinist of the last generation, volunteered his time to come and talk to our patrons, which was incredibly fun. Mr. Perlman, of course, came and played twice with the ESO in the late 90s and early aughts. And so it was a fun chance for some of our patrons that have been around for a long time to remember what that was like, to experience sort of a man who's graced every important stage from the Barbican in London to Carnegie Hall to Sesame Street, and it's just been such a great mouthpiece for our art form, and so that was a really lovely afternoon. We partnered with the Ravinia Festival and WFMT Radio, the big classical station downtown, to present Nicole Heaston recital together with several of our musicians. That was a purely radio broadcast recital, but Miss Heaston brought a wonderful program that included some living composers as well as some beautiful Baroque music. We also, in the final stages of editing our annual Ainsworth concerts, these are our youth programs that usually bring in 9,000 students to Hammond's auditorium. And because, and I was really hopeful I could show a clip, but it's not quite there yet. But because we obviously can't have students in, we were trying to figure out how best to use this program. It's one of our favorite programs. And then speaking with our local schools, we've heard that there's been a lot of difficulty recruiting for fifth and sixth grade orchestra, band and orchestra at the local schools. And so we created a video that is intended to be a recruiting video so that without having a high school kid come in and show the instrument, instead we do close-ups on the instrument, have the instrumentalist introduce the instruments and talk about what they love playing it, and then it pans back and you can see the full orchestra playing these great works of orchestral repertoire. We are collaborating with the Elgin Youth Symphony. And Matthew Shepard, you see pictured there, who is their music director, is now our education conductor, and he did a phenomenal job of stitching this program together. And that takes us to now, and I'll just do a kind of brief overview. So our perception of the biggest challenge facing the performing arts industry in general is reestablishing habits of patronage in the arts as we come out of COVID. And the anecdote, the comparison I always use is that I personally used to eat out every night. It was disgusting and a bad habit. But now that we are in, a pandemic, I've learned recipes. I've learned how to cook. I will spend much less time going out to restaurants. And so we assume that there will be some level of that in the patron base as well. And so we are trying to find a safe and comfortable on-ramp back into the concert hall that will remind people of why they enjoy this program, take some of the lessons we've learned in social advocacy in the last year, and bring people back into the concert hall. And so we are re-upping our collaboration with Gobert's Farm out in Pingree Grove. This design here done Carrie Lou did this beautiful design, the woman that runs the Gin City graphic design shop. So this is the tent that you see here at Gobert's Farm. It is a semi-permanent tent and we can pull the walls off. So it'll be a fully ventilated and outdoor space while the orchestra can be protected underneath the shell. And we're going to present for this series three concerts, which will begin very soon, actually, on May 21st. Limited capacity, obviously, but slightly larger than previously. And beautiful programs, all of them. The first one featuring music of Piazzolla and Tchaikovsky. Second one, an all-American program because of the proximity to the July holiday. This includes West Side Story highlights, Barber's Knoxville Summer 1915, and Gershwin's American in Paris. A great American soprano, Joelle Harvey, will be joining us for that evening. And then we say goodbye to our music director of the past 8 years in a final program of the summer, From Darkness to Light, which features Beethoven's Symphony No. 5 and Schumann's Symphony No. 2. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I hope that was not too wonky.
Thank you, Eric. It was not wonky at all. It's so interesting to just hear and learn more about the symphony orchestra. And I think just it's wonderful that Elgin has such a strong arts and culture. Are there any questions for Eric or comments?
Eric, could you place in the chat where we can go if we wanted to purchase tickets to the event?
Of course.
Thanks.
And also, if everyone, I don't know if you signed the chat, you can put in your name, where you're from, and your contact info so that there can be some networking among everyone. Any other questions for Eric?
Eric, I have a quick question. In terms of the orchestra, how do you have any idea what kind of reception the world of orchestra has among the Latino community in Elgin?
Yeah, I mean, I have to say it's a deficiency, and I in just today the community hadn't been really involved or contacted, and that was sort of a mutual decision, which was really unfortunate. And so we had this this program that we did, the mariachi program, which closed our season in 2020, was a lovely collaboration. I think a really fun evening. We're hoping, I mean, we had already planned on doing that again this coming year, but hoping to expand this into what we're calling Spanish language targeted programming, rather than just a simple, you know, mariachi is one beautiful kind of example of a cool collaboration, but it's not everything. And so creating programming that speaks to also a younger generation is sort of the goal. So next season we will re-up that program, the mariachi program. It'll be the weekend preceding Cinco de Mayo, but the hope is that in the long term this will be a not just a recurring one-off concert, but to be a regular part of the series. So yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other final questions before we move on to our networking activity? Right. Well, thank you so much, Eric. And we're excited to continue to build our partnership with the symphony. For our networking activity, I have a couple of questions that you guys can. We will break you out into breakout rooms and you will have a chance to share. And it's interesting that Eric was talking about how he learned to cook during the pandemic, because one of the questions is to reflect on one thing you've learned about yourself or your life as we have gone through and are still going through the COVID-19 pandemic. And another question is, what is one thing that you hope to do differently as we begin to get back to being a little bit normal as people are getting vaccinated. You're also welcome to introduce yourself, but there will be time for announcements at the end. And I will send the questions through the chat for the group so that you don't have to copy them super fast. Does everyone kind of understand the questions and the exercise? Yes? So Gil, can you help me send people into breakout rooms?
You got it.